Yeah, as it's talking about construction and specification. And we start with one introduction where I want to explain. So I give the motivation for what we do. Then this is a conference with many topics, so I will make a very short course on vertex algebras. I explain to you in 5 minutes what a vertex algebra is. On vertex algebras is Schellingen's list, so I will describe this list. I will not describe this list, but I will describe the statement. And then I will explain what Orbifold theory is. And finally, I will describe some applications. Okay. So let me start with the introduction. So the debating theorem is the classification. This is something you all know that's Riemann's classification of the unimodular lattices in dimension 24. And this is from 1973. So what is the statement? Up for isomorphism, there are exactly 24 even unimodular positive definite lattices in rank 24. There are exactly 24 what do we need? Even unimodular positive definite lattices of rank 24, and moreover, they are classified by their root system. That's something you all know. Such a lattice is uniquely determined by its root sublattice. So that's Niemeyer's result. What is interesting here is that Niemeyer's only paper. He wrote exactly one paper, and that is his result, and then he disappeared from mathematics.
How old was he?
I don't know. I think it was a result from his PhD thesis, and then after that he left. But he proved a very nice theorem in his PhD. And I think there are at least three proofs available for the theorem. Now, the first one uses Kneser's labor method. So you start with one lattice in this genus and then you produce the others by building neighbors. The second one uses modular forms, which is Venkov's proof, which uses Seeger functions with spherical coefficients. And the simplest one, at least when you have the Minkowski-Siegel formula available, is to use the mass formula. So there are these three proofs. And now a similar result is expected to hold for vertex algebras, but there's a conjecture. The structure is very similar. Okay, so up to isomorphism, there are exactly now in three place 24 by 71. And we put all these regularity conditions, they have similar regularity conditions for vertex algebras. So I say strongly modular, and strongly regular. Okay, and so these are unimodular. This is replaced in the vertex algebra language. You say holomorphic for whatever reason. I don't know. Strongly regular holomorphic vertex operator algebras of central charge 24. Okay. And again, these vertex algebras, they are not fixed by their root sublattice, but by the V1 space. I will explain in a minute what that is. So such a VOA is uniquely determined of its V1 subalgebra. I have to say V subalgebra. By 3-1 the algebra. Okay, so this is a conjecture, one of the main conjectures in the theory of vertex operator algebras. And this conjecture can partly be solved by using orbifold theory. And this is what I want to describe. So I will describe what we can prove from this conjecture now. Okay. So, to make a crash course in vertex algebras, so people usually say that they are difficult to understand. I think actually one can explain in 5 minutes what they are. What I should say, so this is joint work as Jeschow von Ekelund and Sven Wender. So what is vertex algebra? From more specifically, a vertex operator algebra. So it's a vector space V together with a state field correspondence which satisfies certain conditions. That's all. Satisfy several axioms.
For infinite dimension.
Usually, yes. So if they are finite dimensional, then they are not interesting. So I write down three of them. So one condition is locality. So these vertex operators, they almost commute. At least when you multiply somehow z minus w. This is called locality. Then we need the Virasoro algebra acting on V. Okay, and under this action, V decomposes into finite dimensional pieces. And these spaces, they are eigenspaces for a zero, so a zero is diagonalizable, and these spaces are finite dimensional. Okay. So this is a vertex algebra, or vertex operator algebra, and now we impose certain. Maybe I give you an example first. So this example is the example which will produce all the other vertex algebras that we need. It's a lattice case. Okay, so here's a simple example. Start with a positive definite, complete even lattice, and you take the underlying complex vector space, then you form the Heisenberg algebra or the central extension of it. Okay. And then you take the subalgebra of negative modes, which you call h hat minus. So this is h tensor. Okay, these are the elements, or this is the subalgebra of negative modes. Then you take the symmetric algebra of that tensorized. This is a group algebra of the lattice, not the real. Well, you have to twist this group algebra. And this gives you an infinite dimensional vector space, and you can explicitly write down vertex operators for this case. That's probably the simplest example of the vertex algebra. And using these lattice vertex algebras, we can almost, we can construct all the other vertex algebras in that conjecture which I formulated at the beginning. And we can also prove uniqueness in many cases, and this is what I want to explain. We need, for lattices, we had this regularity assumption, so positive, definite, even unimodular, and we have analogs of this in the vertex algebra setting. And I only write down the names, so that you have seen that once. Okay, so the vertex algebra is called strongly regular. It satisfies four conditions. So first of all, it should be simple, so it should have no ideals. Okay, then it should be C2 co-finite. I don't want to explain this. This is a good condition. Then it should be rational, which means that it has only finitely many irreducible modules. And finally, and of CFT type. I can explain this because it's very simple. This here means that this series here starts at 0 and E0 is one dimensional and then the other spaces come. Okay, so this means V is equal to C times the vacuum plus V1 plus and so on plus higher terms. Okay. And if you have such a VUA, then it has only finitely many irreducible modules up to isomorphism. And if it has only one, it's called holomorphic. Such a V is called holomorphic. If it has only one irreducible module. And if we go back to this example here, this corresponds to unimodular lattice. So the modules of this vertex algebra, they are parametrized by the dual quotients. So I can write this here. The modules of VL are parametrized by divided by the lattice. Okay. So our lattice example, this vertex algebra is strongly regular, and if the lattice is unimodular, it's even holomorphic. Okay. Then I explain Schellekens list. When did I start?
25 minutes.
I have 25 minutes left?
No, you started.
Ah,
25,
okay.
So.
Okay. So
I have 40 minutes.
Okay. So I can slow down. Okay, so here's Schellekens list. So maybe I won't need 60 minutes. So I make up for the talk before. So here's a theorem. So this result is quite old, and that was proved by a physicist, and mathematicians didn't really believe it, but it's true. It's a mathematically rigorous result, because we took the pain to prove it. Okay, so you take a vertex algebra, a vertex operator algebra, and you assume it to be strongly regular and holomorphic. So it has only one module, namely itself, of central charge 24. I didn't explain what the central charge is, maybe I can do this now. So you know the Virasoro algebra, and the central element acts by some, in this case by an integer, and this integer must be 24. Yeah, that central charge tells you how the central element of the Virasoro acts. Okay. Now you have only under these conditions, there are not many. I forgot to say one thing. But I have to explain it to you. So, if V is of CFT type, then V starts with a vacuum, and then you have the space V1. And this space V1 is actually a Lie algebra. If your vertex size of CFT type, then we run this V-algebra under, so I have to explain what is the commutator of two elements U and V. So you just take the zero mode, so remember your vertex operator looked like this. Okay, and then you take the zero mode and apply it to V. This defines your V bracket on V1. Okay, so V1 has a V algebra structure. And for this V algebra, we have only very few choices. Yeah, so the statement is then V1 is either 0 or V1 is 24 dimensional, or the third possibility is V1 is a semi-simple E algebra, and there's a list, the possibilities for V1 are extremely restricted. Yeah, V1 is 1 of 69 semi-simple algebras. Given an Ellipsis list. There's an explicit list with 69 entries, and they give you the possibilities for V1. Okay. So, and how do you prove this theorem? It's similar to the proof of the list for the Niemeyer lattices. You use modular forms. So, the character of such vertex operator algebra is essentially a Jacobi form of weight zero and index one. So this is how you prove this. You have to decorate it a bit with E2 and so on, but essentially what you get then is the Jacobi form of weight 0 and index 1, and that you can use to describe the structure of these V1 spaces. So now there are several questions. So this is the theorem. The question is now, are these V1 spaces all realized? And the other one is, do they uniquely determine your V up to isomorphism? So these are the two natural questions. And so the existence problem has been settled recently. So we have vertex operator algebras for every possible V1. And in most cases, we can prove uniqueness. And almost all of the known results can be used. That can be proved using orbifold theory. So this here is the famous case of the monster. In this case, we can construct a vertex operator algebra with vanishing V1, but there we probably cannot prove uniqueness using orbifold theory. And in the other cases, we can prove existence of uniqueness with orbifold theory, at least conjecturally, but we have done most cases. So
which one is the most complicated?
This year is the most complicated one because you have nothing to work with. So here you have at least a V algebra, but in this here you have nothing. So, and to this case, our method does not apply. So I will describe orbifold theory, and then there's also something like inverse orbifold theory, and with these two you can prove uniqueness and existence of these two cases. But it doesn't help for the uniqueness of the moonshine model.
So it's not known.
Here the uniqueness is not known. So if you prove that, then it gives you at least a very good paper.
Sorry, physically, what do these adjectives correspond to that you put on your VOA? Are these just 2D parallel CFTs of central charge 24?
Yes.
So the rational here is not the same as rational in the sense of rational CFT?
Yes, it is.
Oh, it is. So they're, yes, 2D rational parallel CFTs of central charge 24.
Yes.
Okay, and then can you help me understand this holomorphic Is that just a very strong version of rationality, or why is it called polymorphic?
Yeah, I didn't. So the terminology was not my idea. So when you have a rational theory, it has only finitely many modules. Mm-hmm. And then there are those which have only one module, namely itself. And these are the holomorphic ones.
Okay.
So I think this is perfectly physicist terminology, or no? Then I apologize. So these are the theories where you have only one module.
Okay. Initially you said, like, Niemeyer's result is now really easy because we have the Siegel mass formula, so you can just enumerate and count, make sure you have all
of them. I mean, that's perhaps an understatement. So, the Minkowski-Siegel formula is a very deep result, so
right.
To prove this, that's not so easy.
Fair enough. Could you imagine something similar in the case of classifying DOAs created by simple
that, actually, yeah, that's my great hope.
Okay.
So I think there should be something like a Siegel mass formula for vertex operator algebras, but that should be different. Yeah, so far it has not been developed. Sorry?
The Siegel mass formula is like sum over something.
Yes, the Siegel mass formula for lattices has the following. You take all your lattices in your genus, and then you sum over the inverse of the orthogonal group, that's a finite number in the positive definite case. And this is a constant which is explicitly known. So when you write down a list of lattices in this genus and you get the right sum, then you know you have all of them. And I hope that something similar would work here. But
what's the denominator?
Sorry?
What should be another denominator?
Yeah, so in this case you have infinitely many, usually they have infinite automorphism groups, but but you can make them finite, so that's the point. So you take the automorphisms, since I have some time, right? So you have to divide them by the inner automorphisms, and this will be finite. So for vertex algebra, you can build a subgroup of this group. You have your V1 space and you look at e to the 2 pi I and then you take an element. This is from V1. Then you can exponentiate the zero mode and this gives you an automorphism of your vertex algebra. You take an element from V1, it has a zero mode, this acts on V. And you can look at the exponential, that's well defined, and you look at the subgroup generated by this element, and you take the quotient, this will be finite. And I think the most beautiful classification theorem would be similar to the Niemeyer lattice proof with the mass formula. So that
but what proof? Because in the Siegel formula, certainly we have the measure. Corresponded Abelian group.
Yes.
Yes, but here, could you imagine,
what
type of arithmetic we would have behind this possible formula?
Yeah, I haven't. So what I think is, this is slightly different talk now, but the dimension here of yeah, exactly. So the character of this thing here is a J function plus a constant. So that means the dimension of V2 is fixed. So, and I think this is the space in which you should work. So I haven't worked on this so far, but I guess that you can deform, you have to define certain structures on V2 and deform them, and then you should describe this in, you should describe the deformations in a mass formula. This is what could work. But, this is speculation at the moment, but this is a space in which you can define maybe some very bright structures looking at deformations and then at the corresponding group. Okay, so where have we been? So I wrote down the theorem here, and I can remove this.
But finally, this is known for monster. Please. Uniqueness for V1.
Sorry? Then?
You don't know uniqueness for V1, but finiteness is known.
Yeah, not even that.
No, okay.
So, yeah, over this case we have no control at the moment. So we don't know whether there are infinitely many VOAs with vanishing V1.
Okay.
Which are not isomorphic. Okay, so, and let me discuss the contribution of all the full series. Okay, so we take such a nice VOA. Okay. And we take some automorphism of the structure. And we assume that it has order n. Okay. And then we define the corresponding cyclic group. Okay, so then what we can do is we can look at the fixed points of this finite group on G. And the good thing is, so it's, a priori, it's not at all clear that this object here is nice. And this took mathematicians 20 years to prove that this thing here is strongly regular again. So this, the fixed points, they inherit a nice structure from V, but it's no longer holomorphic. Yes? So this thing had only one module. This thing here has now many modules, namely exactly n squared.
Sorry, when you say one module, is that a module for Virasoro?
Yeah, of course, yeah, V is a module for the Virasoro. You have to act, V is active. Virasoro is acting on V.
Okay, so my understanding, and I might be wrong about this, is that any CFT with C central charge greater than 1 is automatically non-rational. That is, there are infinitely many Virasoro modules. Is that just not right? Like the only rational guys you get are the minimum models. Rational for the Virasoro algebra, not for any extended carbon.
No, so rational means rational in the sense of VOAs.
The modules for the vertex operator.
Yes.
Okay, great.
Up to an irreducible.
Perfect. Thank you.
So in particular, that, in this case, that's saying it's using the relative start with the module.
Sorry, exactly. When the lattice is unimodular, the quotient is trivial, and then it has only one module in it. Okay, so, and then there's something which I don't have time to explain. There's something called a twisted module for every power of G. This is an irreducible twisted module. So I don't have to explain what this. I don't have time to explain what this is. For enough, for us, it's enough that it exists. And on these twisted modules, you have an action of your cyclic group, and this action is unique up to some root of unity. And now you can decompose these spaces here into eigenspaces of these actions, and this gives you spaces Wij. And the good thing about them is they give you all the modules of this thing here. So we define the spaces Wij, It's not just the IU spaces under the X.
So the statement is Wij are all irreducible for this project.
Yes, exactly. That's what I wanted to write down next. Okay, yeah, and this is a theorem again by Miyamoto and Tanabe. So Vg has exactly n squared modules, and they are given by these spaces.
Then you have a billion group, you again have just size of a billion group square. If not cyclic, but more general, a billion.
I don't know. I mean, so there should be something like a orbifold theory for any group of automorphisms. This is the simplest case. But I don't know. I'm not sure. Yeah, I'm not sure. This is... No, I'm not sure whether that's true. So, okay. So what happens now? So now our G can have different types. So what can happen is the following. So the conforming weight of this twisted module here, this is the smallest, so you have the Virasoro acting on this space, it decomposes into eigenspaces, and you have the smallest weight. That's what I call the conformal weight of the module. And this lives in 1 over n squared times that. And now there are automorphisms which are very particularly nice. These are those where the weight actually lives in 1 over nz, so where you can drop the 2. So G has type 0. Okay, if the conformal weight of this module is in 1 over nz. Okay. Because in this case, we can choose these maps. Where are they? We can choose these maps here very nicely, so that the conformal weight of Wij is given by the normal hyperbolic of the hyperbolic plane. So I write this down. Then we can choose. Yeah, it's such that. Then you look at the conformal weight of Wij, and this is given by I times J divided by N modulo 1. Okay. And then now we have the theorem. So the question is, we have these fixed points, and so this vertex operator algebra is nice in the sense that it is strongly regular, but it has many modules, and we want to build something unimodular. So we take some of these modules and add them to B, to this fixed point space, then we get a bigger vector space, and this becomes, this has a vertex operator algebra structure. That is the difficult part. So suppose. So these spaces, they are all modules for Vg, but nobody tells you how to multiply two elements here. Yeah, that's very difficult to show that this works. So, and this can be proven in the case that the conformal weights are strictly positive, and we have this, then you can add some modules to your fixed point space. And what do you add? You take all the spaces I0 and let I run. So this space here actually has a vertex algebra structure, and this is the orbifold. And this space here, this is the strongly regular and now holomorphic. So this is an extension of the fixed points. The fixed points are W. So this is V00. Okay. So we can extend the fixed points to the bigger vertex operator algebra. And this thing here is strongly regular. And the morphic. Okay. So before that theorem, orbifold theory could be done in order 2 and 3. Yeah? This was what BOA people could do. Now you can do it for any order. Yeah? This gives you much more possibilities to construct new objects. And how does the proof work here? This is an application of the Berliner formula. And now I can describe some constructions. Essentially, yeah, what is the main point of my talk? You can use this theorem and you start from lattice vertex algebras, which you have seen here, and you can construct any V1 and Chadwickens list that you want. So you can get everything from orbifolding a lattice series with the correct automorphism. Yeah, this is at the moment not quite a theorem because we have something like 8 cases missing. So I will write down the precise theorems in a minute. But the take-home message is by orbifolding well-known lattice series, you can produce essentially anything from Chadwickens list. And the second statement is, there's something from this here, you can derive something which we call inverse orbifolds, and they can be used to prove uniqueness. Okay, and with this second technique, this inverse orbifolding, you can prove uniqueness in all cases except the monster. That is what I believe. But again, there we have some cases missing, but at least we have the tools now to solve this problem to a large extent. Okay. So I give you some examples of some theorems. So last section, applications. So here's the first result, which I find nice. So I have shown you that we have these lattice vertex algebras, and you can all construct them from the Leech lattice. Yeah, there's this nice construction. You know, the Leech lattice has something called B poles. These are the points in the surrounding real vector spaces which have maximum distance from the lattice point. And they are one-to-one correspondence with the Niemeyer lattices. And there's a similar statement here for vertex algebras. So let gamma in this vector space, and this is the Leech lattice. Tensor camera, and the isomorphism you take is this. So this is some element in your vertex algebra in this and S H hat minus, and you take zero mode. This is an automorphism, and its order is a Coxeter number. Now, what do you get? What you get when you orbifold with this one? You get the vertex algebra from my axis. What you get? So, in particular, you get all lattice series from the Leech lattice. Yeah? Of order h and type 0. Okay. Then the orbifold theory of the Leech lattice. The Niemeyer lattice theory. Okay, we already have this theory, but I'm not so sure. Maybe the Niemeyer lattice is connected to all the other 71 series. I'm not sure about this, but I know it's at least related to 51 of them. Okay.
Do you have reciprocity for orbifold construction?
Sorry?
Do you have reciprocity for orbifold construction? If you obtain this, then you have some dual actions.
We have the inverse orbifold, and this inverse orbifold is very important to prove uniqueness. That's the next theorem which I want to write down. Yeah, so there's something. You're completely right, there's an inverse orbifold, and you can use this to prove uniqueness. So far there's only existence. So using the method of so-called inverse orbifolding, and some kind of dimension formula. Lam et al. So, and the theorem is 36 out of 71 T1 structures from Shaking Smith. Can be constructed as lattice omnifold. And shown to be unique. Okay, and then you take this 36, which comes from lattices, lattice omnifolds. They are unique and exist. When you have 24 lattice series, they are unique and exist. And this makes them 60. For 60 out of the 71 series, we have existence and uniqueness. Yeah? And then you compare this with the situation. So these results are, many of them are quite recent. Yeah?
But
so
you need to prove uniqueness at least in one case, or at least somewhere, right?
Sorry?
Yeah. So this allows you to go from one to another to say if something is unique,
no,
the other is unique. But which one do you start from? To bootstrap?
So the idea of the, so you start from something you don't know very well, then you go to a lattice theory, and for this you know you have an inverse omnifold with certain properties, and then you can prove conjugation. So this vertex algebra has very few automorphisms in some sense, and then they're essentially fixed by the order and by the fixed point. I can explain to you after the talk.
My question, does it mean for some V1 structure, it's easy to prove uniqueness before you have this? Ah, for
the lattice series. For the lattice series, you can prove existence and uniqueness. And then from you can go from here and prove uniqueness of the other cases. Okay? So, what do I want to say? So we have these three cases in Shelikin's list. It has now been shown by many collection of different methods that all the V1 spaces are realized. I think this can be simplified by orbifolding lattice series. Then you probably also get everything. At least we are very close to everything. And furthermore, you can prove in at least 60 out of the 71 cases that the corresponding structure is unique. So I hope that we can get everything from this part here. I'm pretty sure that we cannot make any statement about the uniqueness of the monster vertex. Okay, so this is roughly what I wanted to say.
The remaining cases you will get by non-abelian architects? And do you have some technique for that?
I hope that we can get them from cyclic orbifolds, but I'm not sure. So maybe cyclic orbifolding is not strong enough. Mm-hmm. So that would be unhappy. I would be unhappy with that.
But the theorem you proved works for the moment only for cyclic orbifolds.
Yes, at the moment it only works. Yeah, for example, so you need, so I think that you need to understand the structure of the fixed points, and I think you have regularity also for arbitrary groups, but I don't know exactly what the modules are in this case. I think it's not only, even in the abelian case, it's not necessarily n squared, it could be more.
I mean, for abelian case, it could be more.
These are abelian groups or cyclic groups?
So, these are what I presented here are cyclic groups.
Yeah.
But for general abelian groups, I don't know.
I mean, can you get anything else than with false?
Sorry?
Can you get anything else with, client fault or something like that? You said you'd be unhappy if you had to look at non-abelian. Would you be slightly less unhappy? plan for. It's just, you were asked about non-abelian groups, and you said something about cyclic groups.
Yes, yeah, but
there are finite groups.
So we are at the very beginning, in some sense, of all the full theory. So the only thing that we can do at the moment is cyclic groups. We cannot do more. So of course it would be good to be able to do more, but even this result is
quite young. Maybe you can prove everything you want.
Sorry?
But maybe you can prove everything you want without doing anything more. Maybe you didn't do anything.
So yes, so all these proofs turn out to be quite difficult. As I said, for example, that to prove that this thing here is strongly regular took 20 years. And I think we had at least 3 proofs which turned out to be false. So it's it's not easy. But so this definitely should be the next step here to allow for more general proofs.
Okay, thank you. Is anything interesting expecting for unimodular lattices of rank 32, or it is just or at least no expected? Or
there's a similar notion there. So the Leech lattice is an extremal lattice, and there's a similar notion for vertex algebras. So-called extremal vertex algebras, they are in some sense as small as they can be when they carry an action of the Virchow algebra. And some people are trying to construct these extremal vertex algebras by orbifolding lattice series in higher dimensions, but they haven't found them so far. But this is something people
do. It's very difficult.
Yeah, it's always quite painful to identify the V1 structure, and we don't have an explicit description of these spaces here. So we only know this is we know this thing here has a vertex algebra structure, but we cannot write it down in general. So the only thing, so if you want to find, for example, the V1 space, you have to use the modular properties of the character and do the calculations over many pages only to find the dimension of V1 here. So this is an abstract result which doesn't use any models, and we don't know the structure of the space in some sense. We even don't know these spaces here. So there are these twisted modules, and the only thing which we know essentially is that they exist. So that makes it hard to work with explicit examples.
Okay.
Thank you, Michael.